Yeah, so everyone feeling cheerful after that? So what's causing it? I mean, there are a bunch of things, right? Occasionally people fake their data. And that's a little bit of it, but it's very rare. Chances are that actually didn't show up in any of these studies where they tried to replicate. That's not really the problem. Sometimes people are really sloppy when they do their experiments or collect their data. And that may be a little bit more common. Again, I don't think that's the huge problem. It may come up in some cases. Sometimes the experiments are just really badly designed. And that also is a possible problem. But again, I don't think that's really driving what we see. I think in those studies that can't be replicated, the vast majority of them were conducted completely correctly. They were done completely right. And so, you know, the puzzle we're left with is, how can it be that if people did these studies completely right, you can't replicate half or two-thirds of them? And I think there's, you know, one simple reason that explains an awful lot of this, and it's the notion of publication bias. This is super important. It's a huge problem in science, I believe. Not an insurmountable problem, as you'll see, for a number of reasons. And science is even working pretty well with publication bias. But I think we can make it a lot better, and I want to talk about that in the rest of our time. So publication bias is what occurs when authors and journals preferentially publish their positive results. You publish the experiments that work. You publish the studies where the drug has an effect. You publish the positive findings and the things that don't work, the drug doesn't have an effect. You mix two chemicals together and they don't go boom. Those you don't bother to publish. And a lot of this is because of peer review. So, you know, peer review is very, very useful for a large number of reasons. I mean, the idea is that before papers appear in the scientific journals, they go through this process of review by other scientists. It's a filter on what's out there. And the filter is useful. It filters out the crackpots by and large. You know, occasionally we miss. It filters out some of the mistakes that get made in papers. That's a little harder. But, you know, some of the statistical mistakes get caught. Some of the mistakes in experimental design or reasoning or mathematics and so on get caught. It filters out, thank God, the boring stuff. Because there's a lot of stuff that people write up that just no one would ever care about. And
by the way, that's Carl's paper, too, if you could read that.
It is my paper. That's a paper that I've had unpublished for 7 years or so, for probably exactly this reason. It filters out the boring stuff. But the problem is, if I do a study and I say I tried X and it didn't work, that's boring. Who cares? I tried to treat high blood pressure with off-label use of this other drug and it didn't work. Who cares? I tried this psychological intervention and it didn't work. Well, who cares? I mean, I'm really good at making things not work in the laboratory. Any of us can do that. And so to some extent, who cares if something doesn't work? And the journals just aren't interested in publishing that stuff. And so what happens is something known as the file drawer effect. I do a study, and if I get a positive result, then it goes into the journal. If I get a negative result, it goes into my files. And no one can ever see it, right? And so, you know, what do I mean by a positive result? Well, you know, one thing might be, you know, we really are serious about these p-values. We talked a little bit about p-values. You know, so if we get a statistically significant result, p is less than 0.05, this kind of arbitrary cutoff that we use, then I publish it. P is greater than 0.05, I set it aside and move on to my next thing. And this creates a really big problem because it highly distorts the representation of the studies that have been done in the literature, right? There's only a certain class, namely these, that are shown in the literature. So let's go back and just remember a little bit from our previous lecture about what p-values are, right? So we've got a null hypothesis. It may be true, or it may be false. We're hoping to be able to reject this null hypothesis, and so then we do our study, and the p-value gives us exactly this comparison. It says if the null hypothesis were actually true, so there's nothing going on, the drug doesn't work. What is the chance that our study would give us a positive result anyway? That we'd mess up and think it was a positive result. And remember, that's not really what we care about most of the time. What we really want to know, you know, once we read the paper, they've rejected the null hypothesis. The paper says, oh, hey, this drug is effective for high blood pressure. Now what we really want to know is, given that we rejected it, what's the chance that it's a true positive, that it really does work, as opposed to a false positive, that it doesn't, but this just happened by chance. So that's if you recall, what these p-values are. Now, the problem is, you know, it's kind of straightforward when I draw this table out like this. But the problem is we don't get the whole table when we read the literature, right? All we see in the literature is this. We don't know whether the null hypothesis is true or false. We just know that some number of studies got positive results and managed to reject it, and some number of studies got negative results and didn't manage to reject it. And somehow, from just knowing these two, we've got to kind of infer, well, is it true or false? And in principle, we should be able to do that. So if the null hypothesis is true, or if it's false, say, if the null hypothesis is false and we can reject it, then we might expect to see something like this. We see, 10 studies that reject it and two that fail. It's not, my experiment is not sufficiently, it's not super high powered, so I'm going to miss a few. If it's false, we should see kind of the reverse, it's a 5% level, we should see 19 or 20, approximately 19 or 20 over here where we don't reject it, and maybe one where we reject it by mistake. And so in principle, we should be able to sort of look at the literature, look at a series of papers, and say like, oh, we're clearly in, we're clearly in this domain, or we're clearly in that domain. Make sense? Here's the problem. This is where publication bias comes in. You don't publish this stuff. That's not interesting, remember? So all you see when you look at the literature, almost always, is you see a few papers that reject the null hypothesis and nothing that accepts it. And that's what you got. And it doesn't matter which case you're coming from. Coming from this case, you see a few that accept. You don't see those. Here, maybe there's more experiments that have been done. You see a few that accept, and you don't see those. And so you can't distinguish between which case you're in. That's a huge problem for trying to infer whether the null hypothesis is true or false by looking at multiple experiments. Now, people are developing fancier and fancier statistical techniques to deal with this problem and figure out which domain you're in, even when there is this publication bias, and that's very good news. But still, we've got to realize that by suppressing all our negative results, it's making it very hard for us to see whether our positive results are these false positives that have occurred by chance or true positives that have occurred because this is something that's really happening. There was a seismic paper that was published 12 years ago called Why Most Published Research Findings Are False by John Ioannidis. This has been viewed over 2 million times for a scientific paper. That's unheard of, right? And the basic argument in this paper is a fairly straightforward paper. The argument is drawing, Ioannidis is an epidemiologist, and he's sort of drawing, and this is sort of the gist of the paper, it's more complicated than this, but the main idea in the paper is, let's think about what happens if you've got 400 patients and you're going to test them for a rare disease. Suppose there's a disease that only occurs in about 1 in 400 people. And suppose you've got a pretty accurate test. It's 99% accurate, but 1% of the time you get a false positive. Now you do the test, and what you end up getting, you get a set of positives for the test, right? So here's four positives for the test. Well, three of them are going to be false positives, and one is going to be a true positive. And so Ioannidis says, well, the same thing is going on in science. If we test 400 unlikely hypotheses, and here now let's test them with a 5% false positive rate, then what are we going to get? Well, we're going to get a bunch of positives. And, in this case, it's an unlikely hypothesis, so only 1 in 400 is right. And then we get all of these false positives. And so in this case, most of the significant results, the ones that, are statistically significant, are indeed false. So that's the logic that Ioannidis is bringing to this. So we've got this problem that by not publishing the negative stuff, we're in trouble. And then we've got this additional problem that the false positives that we do have may be mostly, the positives that we do have may be mostly false positives. So how much of this is a result of hyper-competitiveness in science due to limited funding? That's certainly a contributor, and we'll talk about that a bit in the next lecture. If people had unlimited time and so on, maybe people would bother to take the time and effort to go ahead and write out the negative results and all of this. You're also competing, of course, for mind share. There's only so many papers you can read and so forth. And so I think that also comes into it. I just don't want to read boring papers. And if you tried something and it didn't work in your lab, that's boring to me. And I think that's actually really one of the main things at the core of, of what's going on here, is that it shouldn't be boring if I'm going and looking at a set of papers and want to understand that problem in the context of all the research that's been done. There's no way for me to go find that. Great question. So what we'd really like to know, you know, with respect to, in order to be able to kind of correct for this, is how many negative results go unpublished. Well, the problem is we can measure the fraction of published results that are negative by just counting up negative results in journals. And so across the sciences, about 15% of the published results are negative. And that gets smaller and smaller as we move toward social psychology. In social psychology, only 5% of the published results are negative. It's boring. People don't publish that stuff. But what we really want to know is the fraction of negative results that are published. We don't want to know the fraction of published results that are negative. And that's a little bit harder to get at, because usually we don't know what's sitting in people's desk drawers. But in the case of clinical trials, you have to report a clinical trial to the FDA. And so we do know what's sitting in these desk drawers, in these filing cabinets, because people had to say in advance that they were going to do the experiment. There's a lovely paper that Eric Turner and his colleagues did in the New England Journal, where they went and they looked at clinical trials of antidepressants. And if you look through the journals, like you or I would if we went to the library, this is what we'd find. We'd find a large number of trials up here that show that these antidepressants work, and a very small number of trials, 3, showing that they do not work. Eric was working at the FDA at the time, and so Eric had a different view. Eric was able to see this. Eric was able to see, well, you've got a bunch that show that it works, but you've got a ton that show that it doesn't work. Where did these go? Well, most of them weren't published. A few of them were actually converted into positive results by changing the outcome that they were trying to get. So what's actually happening, you know, this is an accurate picture of what's actually going on. This is what we're seeing. And this is a really, really good illustration of the problems associated with publication bias.